So, in order to assure that I am talking in the scope of this conference, I made a word cloud of the most important words that appear on the conference website. And that looks like this. So I will try to cover every word that is appearing there. And I start with the word international. A question to the audience. How many of you have been traveling more than 500 kilometers to get here? Can you raise your hand? Yeah, quite a few. How many of those have been traveling more than 5,000 kilometers to get here?
Good question. So far, I cannot count.
At least two, which is amazing. We are prepared to travel 5,000 kilometers to go to a scientific meeting. Now, the topic I will be talking about is about 5,000 kilometers away from us. However, you will never be able to travel there. Why? Well, if you make a short journey to, well, a few subway stops to the Natural History Museum here in London, there they explain why. If you go to their exposition on earthquakes and volcanoes, you will see there this model of the Earth. And what I will be talking about is that inner yellow part, the inner core of the Earth, which is 5,000 kilometers away from us. But in another sense, very, very remote. We can never get there. Now, I'm not a geophysicist, so I will spend quite some time in this talk explaining very basic topics from geophysics that I had to learn myself when working on this. So I expect that not many of you are geophysicists either. So you will forgive me to go through these basics. And the Natural History Museum makes this easy for me because it's the job of these people to write very condensed writings next to their objects that explain in a few words to a non-expert audience the objects they are displaying there. So I can just make pictures of these descriptions and go through them with you. So what is this picture about? It's a model of the interior of the Earth, and the Natural History Museum tells us that the Earth is a big ball of rock. The type of rock and the behavior of that rock changes when you move towards the center. There are three main layers. The crust, which is that tiny hard shell on which we live. There is the orange region, which is the mantle. That's plastic rock. And there is the inner region, which is the core, which is metal. The outer core, which is not so well visible on this picture, the outer yellow part is liquid metal. The inner core is solid metal. How do we know that? Well, you know this by analyzing earthquakes, seismic waves that are generated by earthquakes and travel through the Earth. The terminology that geophysicists use for this is a bit different from the standard physics terminology. When they talk about transverse waves, the upper picture, they call this S waves. Longitudinal waves are called P waves in this context. Now, how can you use this to make such a model of the Earth? Let's imagine that there is an earthquake at the North Pole, and there are seismic observation systems around the globe. They detect the waves that are generated by that earthquake. And let's follow one of these red P waves, longitudinal waves. They travel through the different regions of the Earth. And whenever they meet the boundary, they are refracted. And well, by measuring these P waves, you get an idea about where these boundaries are. The S waves, the transverse waves, they can flow only through solid material. A transverse wave cannot go through a liquid. So there will be regions where there are no S waves detected, shadow regions for S waves. So in that way you know that there is this liquid region. Analyzing seismic observations leads you to such a model of the Earth. One of these observations, and one that will play a central role here, is the difference in speed of the wave in the inner core. It has been experimentally or observationally detected that a wave that goes north-south through the inner core is a few percent faster than a wave that goes east-west through the inner core. So that's an observation that puts restrictions on the kind of material that can be there. What is that material? What is that inner core made of? The Natural History Museum tells us the following. They show this meteorite, and they say this is touching this meteorite is the closest you will come to handling a piece of the Earth's core, as it is made of the same material. And in this meteorite, you have predominantly iron and a bit of nickel. That is what the Earth's core is made of. The meteorites are made at the same time in the solar system as the material that goes into the inner core, so it will have the same composition. So we can summarize this as an inner core that consists of mainly iron, 90% iron, a few, well, almost 10% nickel, and trace quantities of other elements, and we more or less know the density. I will keep track of a few keywords throughout the story, and the first keywords I list are, I told about seismic waves, and what is their relation to the inner core of the Earth. The next question we can ask is, we know the chemical composition. What is now the crystal structure of that solid material there? It must have some crystal structure. And as we know that it is mainly iron in there, let's look at the phase diagram of pure iron to get a first hint. Now we'll walk through that phase diagram. There is a pressure axis horizontally. There is a temperature axis vertically. The zero is at the lower left corner. Let's first examine the vertical degree of freedom temperature. When you start at ambient conditions, iron has the BCC crystal structure, body-centered cubic. Most of you will know what that is, but being from Belgium, I have to show the largest BCC unit cell that is available on the planet, the Atomium in Brussels. And usually we display this unit cell not in the way as it is there in Brussels. We have turned it around a little bit, but it's the same unit cell. If you increase the temperature at some point, iron transforms to face-centered cubic. If you heat it even more, it becomes body-centered cubic again, but with a different lattice parameter. And if you keep increasing the temperature, eventually it melts. Now increase the pressure, the right-hand side of this picture. Then, for whatever the temperature is, at some point it will transform to hexagonal closed packed. I will dwell for a few minutes on the FCC and this HCP crystal structures, because these are two examples of the family of closed packed structures. And it's important for the rest of the story to understand what closed packed structures are. How can nature pack spheres as densely as possible? That's what we ask. In two dimensions, that's quite straightforward. Let's look at one example where you see this observationally. This is a close-up of a glass of beer. And if you carefully look to the foam of the beer, you see spheres that are densely packed in two dimensions. And, well, there is only one way how you can do that. One row, spheres next to each other, and the next one fills all the holes in that, and you continue. So this evening, if you are drinking a glass of beer, you can verify this for yourself. I regret to say, but with the British ales, that doesn't work too well. There is not much foam, but I can recommend a Belgian beer that is available in London as well, Duvel. It has a lot of foam, so guarantee that your experiment will be successful. Anyway, even British people know this two-dimensional closed packing very, very well, because it is the starting configuration for the red balls in a snooker game. So let's continue using that example. There is only one way how you can pack these red balls as densely as possible in two dimensions. And I wonder now, what happens if you would add an extra layer on top of this, if you would put a new layer? also here there is only one way. You take a position for that blue ball and you fill all the other positions such that they are touching, and now you have a qualitatively different layer. It's the same in shape as the underlying layer, but it's a bit translated in the horizontal direction. The red layer we call A, the blue layer we call B. And now I wonder what happens if you put a green ball on top of that. That becomes a bit more complicated. You have two options now. You can choose to put the green ball there in the center of this blinking triangle. And if you look under the center, there is a hole in the red layer underneath. Or you can put the green ball in that other triangle. And if you look there in the center, there is a red ball underneath. So these are two qualitatively different choices. I indicate there all the positions where you can have the first choice and all the positions where you can have the second choice. But you cannot fill all these holes simultaneously. You have to make a decision, otherwise the balls would be overlapping. If you decide to fill all the positions where there is a hole underneath, you have again a qualitatively different layer, which we call a C layer. So now we have an A, B, C sequence of closed packed layers. And if you would take that as a unit cell and repeat this infinitely, you have an ABC, ABC, ABC kind of stacking, that's exactly an FCC crystal. You have built an FCC crystal in that way. If you would have taken the other solution, the other possibility, put the green balls on top of an underlying red ball, then you have reproduced the A layer again. And now you can continue to build the B layer and so on. So you have an AB, 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 AB eternal sequence. That's an HCP crystal. So these two crystals, FCC and HCP, are different realizations of a closed packing of spheres. Let's put the data for the Earth on top of that. On top you see the mantle, outer core and inner core, and the typical pressures for the inner core. So if from this pure iron phase diagram, the first hypothesis, the first suggestion looks to be iron will be HCP in inner core conditions. And that is, I would not say the commonly accepted hypothesis, but at least the hypothesis on which most people would bet. There are alternative suggestions, but this is the most common one. So I add to my list that I talked about close-packed iron crystals. So far, when I made my infinite stacking of layers, I have been implicitly assuming that we are dealing with a single crystal. So you build one crystal that is perfect everywhere over the entire universe. That is not how real crystals usually are. Real crystals are fragmented in small pieces, and in a typical piece of matter like this meteorite, they will all have random distributions. So the cartoon of a real crystal, whenever we have a sample available, will look more or less like this. A random packing, a packing of small single crystals, all with random orientations. If that is truly random, you have an isotropic material. So this will be my model for an isotropic material. We were thinking about these seismic waves. So let's examine what is the speed of a seismic wave through an isotropic material. And that brings me to another word in the word cloud, Thomas Young, the polymath who has given his name to your center. He is of course known in this context for Young's modulus that expresses how easily you can squeeze a piece of matter. The response of a piece of matter under uniaxial stress. If Young's modulus is larger, then it's harder to squeeze it. The blue material has a higher Young's modulus than the red material. There are similar materials properties like the bulk modulus, which is the response on hydrostatic pressure, the shear modulus, which is the response to shear pressure. These are characteristics that you can give for any material, also for an isotropic material. Knowing that is sufficient to know the speed of sound in an isotropic material separately for S waves and P waves. So you can express this exactly in terms of these elastic moduli. Another keyword in the cloud was HPC. What has high-performance computing to do with that? Well, you know, by applying ab initio methods to atoms that build a crystal, by using density functional theory in most practical circumstances, you can obtain observational properties of crystals, for instance, these elastic moduli. So you can calculate these elastic moduli by DFT, and you can predict what is the speed of sound in an isotropic material. That is a standard calculation. It will not take you much time. And, well, it's a bit hidden there, but if you do a very precise calculation on a rather complicated crystal, say in one core day, you can get this information. Keep that number in mind. One core day for elastic moduli. So I have talked about the role of DFT calculations in this story. That was for an isotropic material. If you are dealing with a single crystal, things are more complicated. Then it's not sufficient to know the elastic moduli. You need to know the full elastic tensor. The object with 36 elements, 21 of them being independent, that gives you the connection between the stress you apply on the material and the strain, which is the deformation by which the material reacts to that stress. If you know that for a single crystal, then you can predict the speed of sound, which will now not be isotropic any longer. But first, a few words about this matrix of elastic constants. That's a typical example of a property where simulations by DFT are extremely useful. There are only about a few hundred materials where this elastic tensor has been really measured experimentally, where all the components are experimentally known. While with some effort, you can generate this rather easily from DFT. And in the Materials Project database, you have by now about 8,000 materials where this elastic tensor is available. So the richest source of information about elastic tensors comes not from experiment any longer, but comes from DFT. So once you have that elastic tensor, you can get via something that is known as the Christoffel equation, the speed of sound in that single crystal for every different direction. And the name is hidden on the screen again. Jan Jaken, the PhD student who has worked on this, wrote a few years ago a very efficient computer code to calculate, to solve this Christoffel equation and to generate nice pictures about the speed of sound in single crystals. Can be useful for some of you. That takes time. It's more difficult to calculate an elastic constant matrix compared to calculating elastic moduli. I would say for a very precise calculation on a typical crystal, that will take you about 1,000 core days. And that's not so much for solving the Christoffel equation. That is quite efficient in computing time, but that's for calculating these 21 elastic constants. You have to deform the crystal in many different ways and do that very precisely. That takes computing time. Keep that number in mind, 1,000 core days. So let's look at some results for this. I show you the definition of the angles, theta and phi. We have a single crystal of, say, HCP iron, and we will calculate the speed of sound in all directions theta phi. And that gives you this kind of picture. I must say on this screen, on this projector, the color codes are very, very hard to see. So I will have to tell you what you should have seen on a better projection. White, which appears almost nowhere in this picture in reality. White is the isotropic speed. Red is faster than the isotropic speed. And blue, which appears in bands under this red spot, these are regions where the speed of sound is smaller than the isotropic speed. HCP iron. You can use this to express the anisotropy. Remember, inner core speed of sound was anisotropic there, so we want to examine the anisotropy in speed of sound. Take the maximal speed of sound, subtract the minimal speed of sound from this, divide by a reference value, which is the isotropic value, and for HCP iron, that gives you about 6%. For FCC, and this picture is better visible, for FCC, this has a very different shape. Here the anisotropy is about 15%. Now I will draw this information in a somewhat different way now. Starting from the spherical picture, I will unfold this. So the picture to the right-hand side shows exactly the same information as the sphere at the left-hand side. Theta is now running from left to right, and phi is going inside the picture. And I do that because, well, we need to make a hypothesis about what is the orientation of these microcrystals inside the inner core. It cannot be isotropic, otherwise there would be no anisotropy observed in the speed of sound. So it also will not be a perfect single crystal. That would be very unlikely, that we have a gigantic single crystal sitting at the inner core of the Earth. It must be something in between. And planetary models, models for formation of planets, are compatible with the hypothesis that the inner core could be something made of microcrystals that all have their stacking direction more or less in the same direction, but in the azimuthal plane they are randomly oriented. So I will continue with that model. And that is in the terms of the upper picture. That means you have to average that picture over the phi degree of freedom, and you get that kind of curve you see there at the right-hand side. This is a fingerprint of the anisotropy of speed of sound in a cylindrically averaged, cylindrically randomized polycrystal. We can express the average anisotropy as the difference between the maximal and the minimal value. That number we will need a few times. If you do that for the two crystals we have been studying so far, HCP was already cylindrically symmetric, so there is no difference between the cylindrical average and the overall average. FCC had an anisotropy of 15% overall, cylindrically averaged 8%. That sets the order of magnitude of the numbers. So I've told about acoustic anisotropy and how to express that. Now it comes to actual results, where we use this material modeling techniques. And I start from what you experimentally observe. This is this anisotropy fingerprint of the actual inner core. This is what seismic observations observe. So there is more here than just this 5% value, which is the difference between the maximum and the minimum. And not only do you have to fit that number if you want to explain this, you also have to explain the overall behavior of that curve. Let's see what our two standard crystals, HCP and FCC, do in that respect. FCC has an 8% acoustic anisotropy, and the blue line gives the overall shape, not too similar. HCP is more similar. So far so good. That seems to strengthen the hypothesis that the inner core is made of HCP. Apart from the fact that they have been hiding something so far, these are just ground state calculations. This is 0 Kelvin, while the inner core is at 5000 Kelvin. So we need to do something about that. We need to introduce temperature and then see whether HCP still has an acceptable anisotropy. That is where computer time becomes critical. Doing a temperature-dependent elastic constant calculation, where you have to deform the crystal in many different ways and have to do a full phonon spectrum in the quasi-harmonic approximation for every step in the entire deformation, that sums up to a lot of calculations. That's where you need your high-performance infrastructure for. So for one temperature-dependent anisotropy curve, the estimate is about 50,000 core days. So we cannot afford too many of them. I will show you two of these results for two different crystals, HCP being the first one. So this is the 0 Kelvin anisotropy fingerprint for HCP. If you switch on temperature, it becomes like this. The overall value, the AP, is 4.5%, very close to the observed value, but the overall shape is totally off. Such a curve, such a result, that's a fatal blow to the HCP hypothesis for the inner core. It cannot be HCP, it's not consistent with seismic observations. I add to my list, we have made a calculation of acoustic anisotropy at inner core conditions. If it cannot be HCP, what's the alternative? Well, I told you before, HCP, that is this ABABAB sequence, a two-layer unit that you infinitely repeat. FCC was a three-layer unit that is infinitely repeated. These are just two ways of stacking these layers. But you could do that in many, many other ways as well that are less regular. You can have 4 different layers, 5 different layers. I take here the example of a unit of six layers, where you take an ABABAC sequence and that you repeat as a periodic unit. That will be called in what follows the 6-alpha crystal. Or a 6-beta, which is ABACBC. Such irregular sequences are commonly called stacking faults, and the name comes from metallurgy, where you have a perfect HCP crystal, ABABAB, and then suddenly one C layer in between. That's a defect, a planar defect, a fault, so a stacking fault. Here, the stacking faults are so abundant, they appear in every unit cell, so you cannot really call it a fault any longer. It's an intrinsic part of the crystal, a feature of the crystal. But commonly we still talk about stacking faults. A few years ago, we made an exhaustive overview of all possible stacking fault crystals you can build in that way, up to a unit of 10 layers. And the ones that are colored there, that are the ones with which I will continue now. HCP, FCC, two crystals with 6 layers in the unit, and 2 crystals with 9 layers in the unit. They are depicted here. The details do not matter here. So just the collection of crystals we continue with. For all of them, we calculate the speed of sound in all different directions. And you see the results graphically there. What is most important here is the way how these crystals are ordered. I've put HCP at the left, FCC at the right, and the others make visually a kind of continuous transition. And that is really a continuous transition. You can measure for every crystal how much it looks like FCC and how much it looks like HCP and give a unique number to that. And you can put them really on an axis like this. So this more or less scans all the possibilities of stacking fault configurations you can imagine, ranging from HCP to FCC as the two regular extremes. I put on top of them the point groups of these unit cells. Because there is the key of what is happening in this pattern. You see that this pattern is changing from cylindrically symmetric to something different. And symmetry is the key to understand this. We can rearrange this chain in a somewhat different way, like this. And what you see now is not just an animation. This is the subgroup relations of these point groups. So the triangle here in the middle, the -3n, is a subgroup of symmetry operations of the m-3n. So in that way you see that there is one not very symmetric crystal in this family, the 9y, which was about in the middle of the series, so halfway between FCC and HCP, and that has the least amount of symmetry. So few symmetry operations that it is comparable to a random stacking. There is no symmetry left anymore that is related to the stacking direction. All symmetry in that point group is from symmetry in the horizontal plane. So that 9y structure has the symmetry of a random stacking. And that makes it an interesting candidate. Let's see what happens with the speed of sound in such a random stacking. Because in the inner core of the Earth, with such a high temperature available, that will thermally excite stacking fault. A metallurgist will tell you there must be plenty of stacking faults in that material. They have more than enough thermal energy to be created. So if there are plenty of them, then having a random stacking sequence is a valid hypothesis. Well, let's put on that picture the acoustic anisotropy of that 9y structure. First at 0 Kelvin, looks like this, 8.3%. And, well, not too good in agreement. Switch on the temperature. This is the second crystal for which we did the full temperature-dependent calculation. And it gives that dashed line, which is in, well, quite good agreement, I would say. So a random stacking model at inner core conditions, both in pressure and temperature, has an acoustic fingerprint that matches very well with the observations. So I add to my list that I have talked about a model for a random close-packed crystal, and that you could consider the inner core of the Earth as an aggregate of such crystals. That list is complete. I've told almost everything. I can just fill in the blanks there. And I have now my final conclusion. This is the take-home message. The observed acoustic anisotropy of seismic waves that propagate through the inner core of the Earth is reproduced by DFT calculations on a proxy for a random close-packed stacking at inner core conditions. And we conclude that this is consistent with the hypothesis that the inner core of the Earth is formed by not HCP crystals, but random close-packed crystals that have their stacking direction more or less north-south and that are randomly oriented in the horizontal direction. The people who are behind this work is first of all Jan Jaken, a PhD student in our group, who has a very deep insight about this whole elastic formalism and about writing efficient workflows to get all these 50,000 core hours executed without bothering all the other users of the HPC system too much. And because we are not geophysicists, we very much depended also on contributions from Attilio Rivoldini and Tim van Holst from the Royal Observatory of Belgium, who kept our focus close to questions that were really of interest to the geophysics community.